Hello students, I hope you all are doing well at your home. You all are safe, your family is safe, and please listen to your parents whatever they tell you, okay? So, coming back to our topic, we were discussing history chapter 1, the medieval period, and this is video number 3. Before proceeding to the topic, I have received some queries regarding video number 2. I have received some questions from the students who have not understood a particular question or a particular topic. So before proceeding to sources of information, let me first address those queries and then we'll be doing this. And let me tell you, I'm very happy to see that you all are taking active participation in this video classes and sending me your queries which you are not able to understand. So let me address those queries first. Okay, so first question that I received was, a student did not understand how did political stability led to an increase in trade. Okay, so there was a question from a student who could not understand how did political stability led to increase in trade. Yesterday in my video number 2, I told you that with the coming of the Mughals, when they provided us political stability, it led to an increase in trade. Now the question is how? See, what do you mean by political stability? Political stability means a stable government. Here by government, I don't mean the government structure as we have today. I'm talking in terms of history when it was ruled by the king. So, when there is a stable government, when there is a stable kingship, there will be unified laws and policies. Now, when there will be a proper structure of laws and particular policies in a particular kingdom, it will give a healthy environment for trade to happen. This way, when trade will start happening in a particular period, when people will start doing business with other territories, it will lead to an increase in trade. So clear? Clear this question? How did political stability lead to an increase in trade? I'm repeating it once again. Political stability means stable government. When there will be unified laws and policies in a particular kingdom, it will help the kingdom to flourish the trade because it will help them to do trade within their region or the region outside that territory. Clear? Now the second question was, what did Hindustan stand for in medieval times? Okay. So the second question that I received was, what did Hindustan stand for in medieval time? In video number 2, I told you the way we understand Hindustan today is not the same as it was understood in medieval times. Yesterday we were discussing about some scholars who had different meanings for the word Hindustan in their own language. Like, I told you about a Persian scholar, a Persian chronicler. For him, Hindustan meant only that region which was under Delhi Sultanate. When we talk about Babur, for Babur, Hindustan meant the geography and the natural vegetation of the subcontinent. So in this question, how you have to write it? You have to write, listen very carefully, you have to write, the word Hindustan is different in today's era from how it was understood in the medieval times. For example, different scholars in medieval times perceived Hindustan as that territory which was under Delhi Sultanate. For the another example is Babur. For Babur, Hindustan meant the geography and the natural vegetation of the subcontinent. Clear? So these two queries were there. I hope I have addressed your queries and you have understood that. Another thing, there was a confusion that in which copy you have to do the assignment, right? So all the assignment that I'm giving you after the video classes, you have to do it in your classwork copy. Like in video number one, I gave you one assignment. You will write assignment one. You will write those questions. You will write the answer. In video number two, I gave you assignment two. You will write assignment two. You will write the questions. You will write the answers. Is it clear? Shall we move forward now? Sure? Good. Now, today we are going to cover the sources of information. See, our history. How do we learn history? History, everybody knows, is the study of the past. But how do we study that past? That study is done through some information which has been gathered from that time. That information we are going to discuss here. Basically, there are two sources of information which tells us about the medieval period. Those sources are archaeological sources and literary sources. In today's video, in video number 3, we are only going to discuss about the archaeological sources. This literary sources we will be discussing in video number 4. Let us only discuss the archaeological sources. I hope you all are having a copy with you. Please make this flowchart the way I have made it here. Please make it in your notebook. Write down sources of information. This is the chapter name you all have written. Write down this subheading, sources of information. Write down, written. Then you write sources. Make this flowchart. First is archaeological. Second is literary. See, now we are going to discuss what are archaeological sources of information. The archaeological sources are those material evidence like architecture, paintings, coins, inscriptions. Archaeological sources are the material evidence which gives us a detailed information of that particular period. Here we are discussing about the medieval period. So these are those sources of information which tells us about the medieval period. Clear? I'm repeating it once again. I told you there are two sources of information, that is archaeological and literary. Archaeological sources are those sources of information or those material evidence which gives us a detailed information about the particular period. And some of the archaeological sources are architecture, paintings, coins and inscriptions. Now I'm going to tell you what are these sources of information. Okay? You all have written this? Good. Very good. Now, so I was telling you that today, first of all, we will be discussing the archaeological sources. Under archaeological sources, firstly, we are going to discuss about the buildings, temples and monuments. You know, during that time, many kings, they encouraged building temples, especially the kings of the south. They encouraged building of the temples. Why? Because they are a rich source of religious and cultural history. Temples give us a lot of information about that particular period. They are a rich source of religious and cultural history. Another thing comes, paintings. Paintings are another valuable source of information. How do you think paintings act as a valuable source of information? See, paintings, they tell us, they describe us about the custom, food habits, dress and jewelry of that period. By going through those paintings, by seeing those paintings, we come to know about the customs and the food habits of that period. Okay, next we'll discuss about coins and inscriptions. So next important archaeological sources is the coins. Coins act as one of the most important and valuable source of information of the medieval period. Why? Because they give us a detailed information of the dates of the important political events that happened during that period. Understood? See, I'm telling you once again, listen. Coins act as another important source of information for the medieval period because they tell us about the dates of the important political activities that happened during that period. Clear? Next comes the inscriptions. Inscription, another important source. What are inscriptions, by the way? I'm sure you have done inscriptions in class 6. A general idea. What are inscriptions? Yes. See, inscriptions, they are the writings which are engraved on some hard surfaces like metals, rocks, pillars, such type of hard surfaces in which writings are engraved. Those are called inscriptions. Clear? Inscriptions are clear? Now, why inscriptions are important? Because inscriptions give us the detail. Inscriptions give us the details of the evidence. They act as the evidence of the activities of the king of that period. Clear? Inscription acts as an evidence of the activities of the king of that medieval period. Clear? So, I've already told you about what are the different types of archaeological sources which tells us about the medieval period. Here, I'm going to show you some images of different types of archaeological sources so that it gives you a clear idea about whatever I have explained you today. So, let's move forward to that. See, these are the sources of medieval period. Now, for the study of medieval period, historians use a variety of sources. I already explained you that to study the medieval period, variety of sources are used by the historians, which tells us, which gives us information about the medieval period. Those information, those sources are archaeological and literary sources. So here, they have given some examples with images, so that it gives you a clear idea. What do I mean when I say inscriptions, coins, historical buildings and the paintings, okay? Or the religious literature. So this is what, these are the images which gives you a clear idea of different types of archaeological sources. These are some images of the coins. Can you see that? You can see some pictures of coins that were used in the medieval period. And why are coins important? What did I tell you? Why are coins important? Because it gives us dates of the important political events that happened. Clear? Next is inscriptions. I already told you, inscriptions are the writings which are engraved on some hard surfaces. Be it a rock, be it a metal or a pillar. So this is one of the examples of the inscriptions. Next come the paintings. Why are paintings important? What role do paintings play to give us a detailed information about the medieval period? See, I told you, paintings tell us about the custom, food habits, dress or the jewelry of the medieval period. This is another example of painting. Is it visible to all of you? Good. So These are some of the examples. These were some of the images that we have seen that are the archaeological sources. Now, we have seen those images. We have studied about the archaeological sources. Now, I'm giving you a short assignment. This also, you have to do it in your classwork copy only. As you had written assignment 1, assignment 2, now you will be writing assignment 3. You will be writing these questions and you will be writing the answers of these questions. Again, I'm telling you, if you have any doubt on whatever I have taught you today, please write it in the comment section so that I can go through that and I can clear your doubts. Clear? Now, please write down the question. Question number 1. What are the sources of information on the medieval period? This is your first question in which you have to write the different sources of information which tells us about the medieval period. What are the sources of information that we have done today? What are those sources of information? First one is archaeological, correct. Second one is literary. So here you will be writing those two sources of information and then you will be giving examples of those sources. Clear? Now in question number 2 is write down the question. Importance of coins and inscriptions to study medieval period. Write down. Importance of coins and inscriptions to study medieval period. In this you will write, why are coins and inscriptions important? What role do they play to tell us or to help us to study the medieval period? I told you, I had repeated it twice. I told you, why are coins important? When I was explaining through this whiteboard and when I was showing you the images, I told you the importance of coins and inscriptions. So those importance you have to write in point wise in this question. Clear? So these two questions, you have to do it in your assignment. Do it by today. Don't keep it pending for the other day. I have given you, complete it before you get your assignment number 4. Once again, I'm telling you, if you have any doubt, please let me know. I will solve that doubt of yours. Till then, take care and be safe.